We who took up the movement must see now, fully recognised, and realise the danger of becoming once again separated from the mass of people of Ireland, from their demands, their aspirations, and their ultimate irresistible strength. The alternative to elitism, the alternative to idealism with a practical effect, the alternative to being glorious failure with a lost cause fit only for romantic ideas, is to build a revolutionary party.
Sinn Féin was founded in 1905 by Arthur Griffith. It was a right-wing nationalist organisation. During the 1913 lockout, Griffith had referred to Jim Larkin as that representative of English trade unionism in Ireland. After the 1916 rising, support for Sinn Féin grew rapidly. When the first Dáil was established in 1919, they were the largest party represented in it. While Sinn Féin grew, the IRA's military campaign intensified. By 1922, Britain was ready to withdraw from Ireland. However, the treaty negotiated with the British left Sinn Féin badly split. The North East was to remain part of the United Kingdom with its own parliament at Stormont. The majority of Sinn Féin would accept nothing short of a 32-county republic. A bloody civil war ensued between pro-treaty and anti-treaty forces. It was to end with defeat for the anti-treatyites. After the civil war, Sinn Féin split again. In 1926, Eamon de Valera formed Fianna Fáil and took most of Sinn Féin with him. Fianna Fáil grew rapidly throughout the country. In the 1932 elections, they won an overwhelming majority. Sinn Féin, meanwhile, remained a small, isolated organisation. In 1948, it was taken over by the IRA as its political vice.
When the 40s was over, the IRA and the whole Republican movement was in a very, if you like, it was almost annihilated. It was in a very weak position. And it took a long time to try and, if you like, reorganise it, to re-establish it. And then other questions came up then immediately after the 40s. There was the question of why were we always in a position like of just, say, developing towards some kind of a campaign and then emerging from that campaign practically annihilated. And one of the points raised, you see, was that we had no real political arm, we had no... we were never able to develop any kind of publicity for our ideas. We never told people what we were doing. We just went along and done it. And we knew what was good for the people, and that was that. So the idea then of developing what they call the political wing of the movement, like Sinn Féin, developed. But unfortunately, they developed them on very... old and straight-laced ideas. They weren't, to a great degree, they were very reactionary.
In the early 50s, when there was just the reorganisation of the Republican movement, as it was called, was beginning to take shape. It was beginning to attract some support, beginning to make small presence felt. And its appeal was mainly a nationalist appeal. It was a question of British troops occupying part of Ireland and to finish the job. So that was the basic and main appeal. There was no appeal to any other aspect of any other philosophy or ideology. And within the movement as it was then, there was the IRA structure, which was the dominant one, which it decided and determined what happened to the movement. Sinn Féin, as it was then, was purely and simply a support group for whatever activity the IRA, as it was then, engaged in.
My first involvement with politics was in 1952, when I was 12 years of age and asked to join Na Fianna Éireann at that time. In 1952, there was quite a lot of talk and discussion about partition. and about how all of our problems in Ireland stemmed from partition, and that if we could only get rid of partition, that the emigration, which was then rampant, could be stopped, and Ireland could be a land of milk and honey, as they used to say. So, as I said, it was primarily a scouting organisation, but it was very much a Republican nationalist scouting organisation. And it was from there on that I progressed from the Fianna into Sinn Féin and became directly involved in the political arena.
Well, I think from 1954 there was a successful one. Successful armed raid in Armagh in 1954, which generated a good deal of support and brought a good deal of members to the IRA and Sinn Féin then. From in 1955 then, the movement was taking off in a big way, and then had succeeded in electing two MPs to the British House of Commons, Tom Mitchell and Philip Clark in Mid Ulster and Fermanagh, South Tyrone. And the British attempted to unseat these, which they did at the end of the day, but this also generated more support and sympathy for the movement and its policies. And the whole effort, though, of the IRA as such, which was the cornerstone, the kernel of whatever movement was there, was organising for a military campaign against the British in Northern Ireland. And this was the line and the activity of everybody involved in the movement.
1956, the IIRA launched its campaign in December, this December the 12th, 1956. And I think within a matter of months, the campaign had more or less faltered. And in the early stages of it, I think it was the end of December, the early in January, Sean South and Fergal O'Hanlon were killed in the process of a raid on Brookborough Barracks, and there was a number of volunteers who were wounded at that time. But the campaign, as they say, faltered after a short period of time, although it did continue until 1962 in a very low-key fashion. So that the electoral support that existed in 1955 certainly didn't translate into a massive support for a military campaign. Certainly a military campaign which avoided any kind of sectarian involvement, because I think the distinct difference between the IRA of 1956 and the IRA of the provisional IRA of the present day is that at that time in 1956 it was a specific policy to avoid generating any kind of sectarian backlash or sectarian involvement. And I think that is the key difference between then and now, whereas you have now the provisional IRA directly involved in sectarian murders and sectarian activity, and it is on this that it has built its support amongst the Catholic population in the north.
Come all you young rebels and list while I sing, for love of one's land is a terrible thing. It banishes fear with the speed of a flame, and it makes us all part of the patriot game. My name is O'Hanlon, and and I'm just gone 16. My home is in Monaghan, there I was weaned. I was taught all my life cruel England to blame. And so I'm a part of the patriot game. 'Tis barely 2 years since I wandered away with a local battalion of the bold IRA. I read of our heroes and wanted the same, to play up my part in the patriot game. They told me how...
With the end of the border campaign in 1962, a major rethink began within the Republican movement. The movement began to analyse the mistakes and failures of the past and to map out a new direction for the future.
That's then... was the beginning with a complete change in leadership, of a complete new thinking. Throughout 1962 and 63 and into 64, with constant and regular meetings and all night meetings and 2 and 3 day meetings, and where you know, we re-examined the whole historical base of republicanism, what it was about and what we were about, and this whole question of campaigns, and you know, decided that this idea of having to, every time one campaign finishes, start build up for another campaign, was a total waste of time and effort. That the whole thing should be a development of a political process, and to get public support for a particular ideal. And through this process of discussion and argument, etc., we developed some of the socialist ideas which were springing up during the time in the Curragh and in various jails.
I felt, for one, at that time, that there was 2 big stumbling blocks, and one of them was the abstentionist policy, and but the main one was the fact that we had no real political ideology. In other words, that people joined us because they had a vague notion of Irish freedom, and everybody had a different idea, and there was no coordination and there was no great political discipline. So we felt that that was one of the first things that we should correct, that we should have an objective, and it should be a definite one, whether we're going to have a socialist republic or we're going to have something else. And most of us opted for a socialist republic.
The campaign ended in 1962. In the meantime, something in the region of 200 members of Sinn Féin and the IRA were arrested and interned in the Curragh internment camp, and of course there were a couple of hundred people also serving prison sentences, and I think also were interned in Belfast. I myself spent close on two years in the Curragh, and there was quite a lot of discussion all during that period on what Sinn Féin ought to be doing, what exactly was the purpose of getting rid of the border, who was to benefit, and so on. And that quite naturally led to discussion of socialism. I should say that prior to that, there was a definite policy of discouraging any discussion of socialism in Sinn Féin. And socialism was regarded as communism, and communism was regarded as anti-God, and therefore it was to be discouraged.
The new approach of the Republican movement led to greater involvement in social agitation. the movement became involved in campaigns on a wide range of issues.
We decided that the campaign that we would be involved in would be political campaigns, but open political agitationary campaigns on the streets and wherever else for particular issues. And we gradually, 1964 and 65, began to get involved in some issues and campaigns in down here in the south.
Sinn Féin, at any rate, became very deeply involved in cooperatives, and also became involved later on in the 1960s in housing action. I might add that in 1966, the 50th anniversary of 1916 took place, and there was commemorations and remembrances all over the country at that time, and that as well helped to revive an interest in the writings of James Connolly, and there was a considerable development of discussion and reappraisal of his writings, and this as well helped to direct Sinn Féin and presumably the IRA of that time towards a socialist perspective of the country and of the problems of the country. As a development of that involvement and interest in people's everyday problems, there were two developments. There was the establishment of the Republican industrial section, and there was also the establishment of Citizens Advice Bureau by Sinn Féin. And this sort of indicated our growing interest in industrial growth in the trade union movement, and also in the day-to-day problems of the people. The Citizens Advice Bureau was a relatively new idea in Ireland. As far as I know, Sinn Féin was the first political party to establish that kind of a service, and it's out of that particular involvement that the housing action committees grew, because a large number of people came to us with housing problems. At that time, Dublin Corporation were only building something like 200 houses per year, and there was a huge waiting list of something like 10,000 on the waiting list. A number of Georgian houses had collapsed, and in fact I think a number of people had also been killed as a result of those housing collapses. In any event, the Housing Action Committee was established by Sinn Féin in 1967, and I was the first chairperson of that committee, and we involved a number of people who came to us with housing problems on the committee, and we organised marches to City Hall, public meetings. We engaged in campaigns of interrupting the meetings in City Hall in order to draw attention, public attention, to the fact that the corporation were not building sufficient houses for the homeless people in the city. Now, other housing action committees developed as well. There was one in Cork, there was one in Derry, and I think there may have been one in Galway as well. But as well as that, you see, there was other agitations in progress. There was a ground rents agitation in progress as well. And there was also the National Waterways agitation. This was a campaign to have the fishing rights restored to the people. All of the fishing rights, or most of the fishing rights around the country, were still in the hands of Lord This and Lady That, and that too was a successful campaign. So that there was this whole development of social agitation and campaigns for the restoration of natural resources to the people.
In Northern Ireland, the new departure led to involvement of the movement in the embryonic campaign for civil rights. This was to have a greater effect than anyone could have anticipated, both in Northern Ireland and within the Republican movement itself.
At the same time, in Northern Ireland, we began to gradually build up. Various ideas were coming forward. I remember there was a one man, one vote campaign, and committees established against the franchise system in the local government system. At that time, the voting was on property, and there were something like almost 100,000 people disfranchised in local government, didn't have any vote because it was based on property. And we began initiated campaigns on that, which really weren't getting any place, but they were our people were being educated in what the type of things they should be doing. And then we also had established the Wolfe Tone Societies in Dublin and Belfast, Cork, a few other places, which became outlets for ideas and development of new ideas from our own people and people outside, etc. And a number of these were absorbed. And through these things, the idea of a civil rights campaign emerged.
The Republican movement then were participating, along with many others, after 1966, 67 and 68, in the formation of the Civil Rights Organization. This, of course, was a body that were out to gain some reforms in Northern Ireland and were highly critical of the deficiencies within the Northern Ireland government, particularly in the whole area of jobs and allocation of houses. Indeed, it was a result of the early successes of the civil rights struggle, when large numbers of people come on the streets of Northern Ireland to support the civil rights demands. And I think it's important to point out that the civil rights were looking for reform in Northern Ireland. It wasn't as if there were revolutionary demands. And I think that that's what made their appeals so widespread. And indeed, it was the right-wing reactionaries within the Unionist government at that time felt that they had to stop these demands and indeed stop the civil rights marches.
And the civil rights movement started to develop in the six counties. It caught the imagination of people a lot quicker and a lot more forcefully than most of us thought it would. And events then, like, more or less took over from us, and they went on very quickly. And there was then so many different groups, like the student groups and People's Democracy and a lot of others involved in the periphery of it, and started to organise marches and demonstrations on their own against the wishes of the executive of the civil rights movement.
Our members in the North were on all of the marches, and their job, in fact, was to try to ensure that there wouldn't be violence, and because they were instructed to see that wherever violence came from the police or those opposed to civil rights, which would be the Paisleyite crowd in particular. And that was the objective that our people were given in the front of all the marches. They were acting as stewards, and in fact, they were instructed, you know, if the batons are drawn, well, you just cover up your head and go into it, you don't attack. And that did continue quite successfully for a period, but there was a number of civil rights marches did escalate into violence, particularly in one in Uri, I recall. And, you know, people who didn't understand what the civil rights campaign was about. We had a very clear political understanding, And one thing we made clear was it wasn't a Republican campaign and it wasn't a socialist campaign. It was a campaign for civil rights. In fact, as clearly stated, it was for equality of citizenship with the rest of the UK. That was what the civil rights campaign was about. And that's what gave it its international appeal, and that it was supported worldwide because it was peaceful, because it was just and seemed to be just. And but there were many factions developed in the civil rights campaign, with the PD having their own idea of trying to make their idea of extreme left socialism. And then there were others who wanted to develop it into a Republican campaign. And you had quite a lot of opposition from a number of our people to the whole civil rights campaign. And these were the people who later became the Provisionists.
Will you people get away? Get these people out of there, loading, get a fucking emergency out here. Go on! Hey!
The civil rights campaign, of course, moved much faster than anyone had anticipated. And the demands of the civil rights campaign, it should be recalled, was not for the abolition of Stormont, or not for the withdrawal of the British Army, or any of those demands, but simply the democratisation of the society in Northern Ireland. One man, one vote. Equality in jobs, fair allocation of housing, and various other the elimination of various other kinds of discriminations. And that won such huge support and created a backlash from the unionists. Which led to the pogroms and riots of 1969.
We had many members of the Republican movement in Belfast, and indeed other parts of Northern Ireland, who had not participated within the Republican movement, or from that had gotten out of jail in the early 1960s, and now seen these flare-ups of sectarian confrontation as the green light for them to come back into the Republican movement.
Those who had stood back from the agitation and stood back from the civil rights campaigning demanded that the IRA defend the Catholics. And that, as I said, created something of a crisis. Other elements, such as Fianna Fáil, also saw opportunities for themselves. And indeed, when I say Fianna Fáil, I should say elements in Fianna Fáil saw opportunities for themselves. And they attempted to buy off Sinn Féin and the IRA at the time.